quiz. Pop quiz, test. Don't worry about failing. It's personal opinion. Set up the test. How many of us identify ourselves as followers of Jesus Christ? If you're not in that category, I want you to know that our greatest desire is for you to learn about Christ and decide to become His follower. So if you're not in that category, at the end of the service today, if there's not somebody sitting near you that invited you that can talk to you about that, I invite you to come down to the front and talk to, there will be some folks gathered here at the front, and they will be leaders in our congregation that are here, and they'll be glad to talk to you about what it means to establish a relationship with God through Jesus Christ and follow Him. For those who have made that decision to become a Christ follower, several questions with regard to that. One, who first exposed you to the message of Jesus? In other words, how did you first hear about Jesus? And I could add to that, how did you most consistently hear about Jesus? Another way of stating that question would be, who first, for example, invited you to church? How did you first begin to attend church? Under whose influence? That's the first question. Second question is, when you made a decision to follow Christ, when you made a decision to become His follower, how old were you? How old were you when that happened? Third question, and I can't answer this one accurately. I can answer it generally, and you probably can't either, but it's a provocative thought anyway. Before you made the decision to follow Christ, how many times was the message of Jesus explained to you and presented to you? The message that Jesus Christ came to this earth, the God-man, 2,000 years ago. He had no sin, as opposed to us who are sinful. Therefore, He was under no condemnation. Yet He willingly allowed Himself to be brutally executed on a Roman cross. And because He had no sin of His own to die for, God could credit His death as the vicarious punishment for others who were under a death sentence. That would be us. And having said that, that He proved that He didn't die for Himself, but He died for somebody else when He rose from the grave on the third day, because God confirmed the validity of His death for all of us through His resurrection, and that all of us who call on Him and trust Him today as our sin bearer and the one who died in our behalf, that today as we call on Him and trust Him, that God can credit His punishment to our account and satisfy the just condemnation and the wrath that we deserve, and will deliver us from that, and as a tremendous bonus, give us His own life that begins right now. That's the essential message of the gospel. So how many times did we hear that or were exposed to it before we finally decided to make a decision to follow Christ? Well, if to the first question, who first exposed you to the message of Jesus, if you answered a family member or a friend, you would be in the 75 to 90 percentile of people. Studies have been done to document, and they find that 75, depending on which study you read, so pick a number in the middle if you want to, but 75 to 90% of people who make a decision to follow Christ were brought to Christ and exposed to Christ and the message of Christ through a family member, primarily a parent, or a friend. 75 to 90%. So the stereotype that evangelism is something that primarily happens like in a large Billy Graham crusade or some sort of evangelistic event or people going out and canvassing the neighborhood and knocking on doors and all of that, all of which are legitimate manifestations of spreading the good news of Jesus. But the stereotype that that's the typical way that people come to faith in Jesus is a false stereotype. And I would say that if we surveyed here this morning, that we would discover that the majority of us were exposed to the message of Christ through a family member or a close friend, and even maybe a parent being the first ones that took us to church. That's not exclusively true, but it's primarily true. Now, that's an important point and data, a statistic to remember for our message today. The second question, how old were you? Well, if you answered 18 years old or younger when you first made a decision for Christ, you would also be in the majority, the overwhelming majority. We talk about the 10:40 window, which is, is Jonathan out there? Jonathan Detweiler? There you are, Jonathan. Jonathan works with Uttermost Sports, and they focus within the 10:40 window with outreach through sports, right? So make sure I get this right, Jonathan. I'm not real good on my geography. I don't think I... But the 10:40 window is 10 degrees longitude and 40 degrees longitude, right? Latitude. There you go. I've already gotten it wrong in two sermons this morning. Okay, so it's latitude. There you go. So now I got to go back and correct myself. But anyway, 10 degrees and 40 degrees latitude, that the overwhelming majority of people who are not identified as Christ followers or have a legitimate witness within their people group or their culture exist in that geographic region. Correct? Okay. Now, how many of you have ever heard, taking the 10:40 window, how many of you have ever heard of the 4:14 window? Let me illustrate. We've got a couple of slides that show charts. The first is a pie chart, and this is a pie chart, and it documents that 85% of people who make a decision to become a follower of Christ are between the age of 4 and 14 when they make that decision. 85%. So that's the 4:14 window, as some describe it. And then you can read yourself the other breakdown of the other ages. Here's another chart provided by the National Association of Evangelicals that's the same focus of survey, but it's a little bit different results, but it's essentially the same. They overlap. The number of people, the percentage of people that come to Christ before they're 3 years old are 1%. The number that come between the ages of 4 and 14, according to this, are 63%. But then you look that between 15 and 29 are 34%. So 97% of people who identify as Christ followers came to Christ before their 30th birthday, and the overwhelming majority of those came far younger than that. So even though the 85% on one chart, 63% on the other, again, pick a number, it's still overwhelmingly in that age range. And then, the last question, how many times did you hear about Jesus before you made a decision? Well, again, somebody's done research on that as well. And what they have discovered in that research is that the average person decides to follow Christ after they heard the message of Christ presented to them clearly 7.6 times. 7.6 times on average. Now, having said that, I remember having a conversation with a person on staff with Jews for Jesus, who their exclusive job was to work among their own Jewish people and share the good news of Jesus. And the percentage of Jewish people that make a decision for Jesus are incredibly small, tragically. But that being said, I asked this person, I said, when you have seen a Jewish person make a decision to trust Jesus as their Messiah and Savior and begin to follow him, I said, when you have seen that happen, I said, what is the average time that you spend with them before, in other words, from the time you encounter them and begin a relationship and begin to share about Jesus with them, what is the average time that you spend with that person before they actually decide to trust Christ? And their response was to say, I'd say typically it's about 3 years. It's about 3 years of intense interaction with that person before they decide to trust Christ. Now, that statistic ought to be, now that doesn't say you have to hear it 7.6 times. Remember that. I've just said this is what people report as their experience in the average. Doesn't mean you can't respond the first time, but the average person has that many. And what I would say is that in light of that, when you have shared the good news of Jesus with somebody and they haven't responded positively, cheer up. You might be number five. You might be number five. But that seriously should give us a degree of encouragement in regard to that aspect. Now, with that data and those facts as a context, let's ask this question. Anybody here ever heard of the Apostle Peter? He would you agree with me that he would probably be one of the top five in the Bible if you started naming names? I mean, Peter would be right up there, wouldn't he? And in the New Testament particularly, Peter and Paul, followers of Jesus, it kind of, everybody's behind them. Wouldn't you agree? That'd be my contention. Now, that being said, how would Peter the Apostle have answered those questions that we just answered? What would have been his response? Well, we don't know all the answers to all the questions that we ask, but we could answer some of them, and in fact, I think the most important one, because the Bible clearly tells us. Today, we're starting in the New Testament, and I hope if you see on your bulletin, if you're behind, you could catch up. I think today we're in Matthew 22, reading through the New Testament by Easter. I had someone come up to me this morning, a little fellow that I'm not sure, but he was about 8 years old. And guess what? He's reading through the New Testament. He said, I'm a little bit behind, but I'm trying to catch up. I said, God bless you, man. Go for it. And that being said, as we begin that journey through our corresponding passages from our Sunday morning life groups, then today we're beginning in the New Testament, and we're going to focus on John chapter 1, and we're going to read together a passage in just a minute, but I want to set that up by saying John the Baptist was the forerunner of Jesus. He set the table for Jesus. And John the Baptist had disciples, and when Jesus came along, John the Baptist said to his disciples, the people with whom he had an existing relationship, look, there's the Lamb of God. Okay? And many of his disciples left him and started following Jesus. All right? That's the context. So let's look at John chapter 1 and begin with verse 35. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, look, the Lamb of God. When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, what do you want? They said, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Come, he replied, and you will see. So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 p.m. Now, let's conclude. I want you to join with me in verse 40. Let's read together. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Now I want you to let this soak in a minute. Let this soak in a minute. This is not a complicated account. Just let it soak in. And remember that statistic that we saw, that 75 to 90% of people who become followers of Christ do so because of the influence of a family member or a friend. So let that soak in. And having done that, let's understand that Andrew had a relationship with John the Baptist. And it's through that relationship that he was exposed to Jesus. Andrew heard from John, with whom he already had a relationship. And then, and I love this line. I love this line in verse 41. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him. I mean, what is clearly implied in that statement? Once he discovered Jesus, once he discovered the truth about who Jesus really is, and once he himself had established a relationship with Jesus, he could not contain himself. He had to go find his brother. His brother was the first thing on his mind. Now, let's repeat something that we say sometimes and have repeated here in Deltona Alliance Church. Well, all of us aren't here every Sunday, so some of us may not have heard it. But after all, we got to hear it 7.6 times before we get it anyway. So it doesn't hurt to say it again. How many of us are familiar with the word evangelism? The word evangelism is not a translation. It's not a meaning equivalent. The word evangelism is a sound equivalent of the Greek word that is found in your New Testament, euangelion. Euangelion. And euangelion, if you use the letters to form the sound of the original word in the Greek and you write in English, it comes out evangelism. However, if you translate it, if you put it in a meaning equivalent, the most common way that word is known among folks who have a church history and a church background is the word gospel. But that's an old English word that was used 400 plus years ago when people originally translated the English Bible from the original Greek and Hebrew. And they used the word gospel to translate the Greek word euangelion. So anytime you read your Bible and you see the word gospel, G-O-S-P-E-L, know that the Greek word behind that is the word evangelism. It's the word euangelion. Well, that was their translation of it, but it's become Christianese and cliche. But so when we see the gospel according to Matthew, the euangelion according to Matthew, that's what that means. It's the evangelism according to Matthew. Now, or the evangel as it would be in that particular form. Now, that being said, what then is the translation that we would understand? What is the translation that we understand to put it in a contemporary language? You can't translate it in one word. It's a phrase, and it means a messenger of good news. A messenger with good news. That's all the word means. That's exactly what it means. The word euangelion is the word evangelism, and it simply means a messenger of good news. And to emphasize and to reiterate that, the word euangelion, evangelism, is simply in the original Greek is the word angel with an EU in front of it. Angelos is angel. That's the reason it's angel in your English Bible. Because it's transliterated. It's not translated. You translate the word that reads, anytime you read the word angel in your Bible, it means messenger. It simply means messenger. That's all it means. That's what it means. Okay? And so the word evangelism is the word angel with an EU in front of it, and the EU is a prefix to mean positive, helpful, good. That's the reason at a funeral people give a eulogy, a eulogy. It's the word logos with an EU in front of it. It's a good word. At a funeral, you say a good word about the deceased, and that's called a eulogy, because that's what it means. Well, you take the word angel, you put an EU in front of it, you've got evangelism. You've got a messenger who's got good news. You've got a friend who's sick, and they can't get well. And they're burdened and bummed out about it, and you are too. And guess what? You discover a medicine that will cure them. You run to their house and you say, guess what? Take this pill and you're going to be okay. You were a euangelion to that person. You were a messenger of good news. And the reason I emphasize this and overemphasize it is because, again, back to stereotypes and preconceptions that are robbing us of what the Bible really has for us. Is that when we use the word evangelism in our common Christianese, we think of something very elaborate and, in most of the time, frightening for most people that we could never do. It's like, well, we got to be a Billy Graham, or we've got to stand on a street corner or whatever. And that's fine. Those are wonderful manifestations of evangelism. But the essence of the word, the essence of the word does not require that, nor does it limit its expression to that. Andrew evangelized Peter. Man, I have found the Messiah. I'm so excited about this, I can't contain it. That's, in its purest form, what evangelism is based on the language used in the New Testament. An evangel was a person delivering a good report, good news. And furthermore, the neat part about it is that as Andrew came to Peter, Andrew didn't have to come with a canned presentation. Andrew came with his own story. Andrew came, I have found the Messiah. He's real, I know him. And here's what he means to me, and I commend him to you. See, we go to a restaurant, we eat a really great meal, first time we've eaten there, we get really excited about it. What do? Well, our family members and our friends that we talk to, man, we had a great meal last night. We ate so-and-so, so-and-so, and it was a great meal. Nobody has to coach you in that. Nobody has to cajole you to do that. No, nobody has to plan or program that. That just comes out of you naturally. And that's exactly what Acts 1:8 is talking about. And that's exactly what I mean when I summarize Acts 1:8 in the phrase, brag on Jesus. You see, Andrew bragged on Jesus to Peter, pure and simple. I have found the Messiah. Whoa! What do you think? And why am I emphasizing this so much? Is because Andrew should give us great hope, because what he did, not only can we all do, we all already do. When you find something that you really like and are really happy about, you don't have to be coached or encouraged to tell somebody else about it. And the first people that hear it are the people that are closest to you. Now, Andrew helped Peter meet Jesus. And if you don't know it, let me just give you a hint. All the fill-ins are Andrew. Thus far. Andrew helped Peter meet Jesus. How many Apostle Peters are there in your family right now waiting to have somebody come up to them whom they love and trust to say, I got to tell you, I found Jesus and he's the best thing that ever happened to me. And I'm praying that you can find him too, and I'll be glad to help you with that anytime you're ready. How many Peters are there in your family, in your close friends, that are waiting to hear that message? And understand, the last thing Andrew did is that it says, I love the last line, he brought him to Jesus. You know, in other words, it wasn't just enough that he told him about him. He said, come on, let's go with me. I'll introduce you to him. I was having a conversation with a pastor friend this week, and he was telling me he was a Georgia Bulldog football fan. He was a tried and true Georgia Bulldog football fan. He was a little fellow when Herschel Walker, the great legendary player at Georgia, was playing. And he said, I knew everything about Herschel Walker. I knew his shoe size. I knew, I mean, you know, his yards, how many yards he, I knew everything about Herschel Walker. But he said, today, if Herschel Walker walked up to me and I stood up and looked at him and spoke to him, you know, he said, you know what Herschel Walker would say to me? I haven't got a clue who you are. I know all about Herschel Walker, but I don't know him personally and he doesn't know me. Now, the point is, that analogy is not a perfect analogy, but the principle holds. You can know all about Jesus, but at some point you got to meet him. At some point you got to make a decision to meet him. And this church is here to help people know all about Jesus, and this church is here to help people meet him and help inspire people to help others to meet him. You see, without Andrew, there wouldn't have been a Peter, the apostle. Who is there in your life that's waiting to hear? You see, because here's what we learn, not only from this passage, not only from the data that we showed earlier that confirms this truth, it's a maximum that's been true since day one, and it's still true today. The good news of Jesus travels the road of relationships, pure and simple. The good news of Jesus travels the road of relationships. So what I'd like to do to close, and what I'd like to challenge you with, you know, every sermon should end with a so what. Here's the so what. You see two more fill-ins on the bottom of the sheet if you're looking at the notes. And they both have an F in front of them. The first one stands for family, and the last one stands for friends. And I want us to prayerfully pause for just a minute and pray about whose names need to go on there. Who is there in your family that's not intentionally walking with Christ? And God has placed you there to be Andrew in their life. Who is it among your friends that needs the same? And I've already filled this out, and I'm continuing to think about it, refine it as God would have me. And I'm sure that I could put a big long list, but you do it however you want to do it, and have the Lord lead you to do it. I'm just telling you that for me, I didn't feel comfortable putting all the names I could have put on there. But I just put a couple that I want to focus on that are primary. And that doesn't mean that I'm excluding the others. But as I see them start to follow Christ, then I can expand the borders a little bit. So don't feel the pressure that you've got to reach the whole world by yourself. But God wants to use you to reach your world with Him. So right now, we're going to pause, and I want you to prayerfully consider making this commitment and who those people would be. I hope that you'll continue to ponder this and that you will respond and be willing to hear from Christ to bear fruit through you in the people that He's brought your way. Because these people are in a relationship with you, and it's not by accident. And I will tell you that the reason it's easy for me to talk about Jesus with you and with others is simply because the Galilean Jew has captured my imagination and my heart. And that's the exciting thing about us reading through the New Testament before Easter. I pray that you'll get exposed to Jesus in a way you never have before, and that He'll capture your heart if He hadn't already done so. Because everything in life I have discovered once I've actually read the Bible is boring compared to Jesus. And the last thing I want to say is this, and I'll go back full circle, as we had a presidential inauguration this week and all of that, and we get excited and worked up, and you know, we're worried about this and that, and we put it seems like sometimes more emphasis on who the politicians are than Jesus. And last time I checked, He's the one that's really running the show. Whether they know it or not. Hallelujah. That's what I say. Hallelujah. And let's just pray that they get it. But that being said, what if it was you that was sworn in as president of the United States this week? Would you think that would be an important job? Think it was you up there. I know that's a nightmare, right? You don't want to think about that. But just pretend for a minute. What I'm submitting to you, I know this sounds crazy, but you're too late. I've read the Bible. And I understand enough of what it says to understand this. That you doing this and fulfilling this and starting to pray for these people and being used of God to reach these people is more important than if you were president. Because I will tell you that if the church in America and in the world would get this, and we would see in 1 year the kingdom come to this earth. Mm-hmm. So get on it. Get on your knees before God with this list and pray for these folks till God opens a door for you to speak into their life, and watch what God does with you to bring them to Jesus. Another Simon Peter through you. Amen.